नमस्कार, गुड आफ्टरनून। यू आर वॉचिंग अस ऑन पीएमए विद्या चैनल और मैं हूं आपके साथ रेणु भट्ट। एंड द टॉपिक दैट वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस टुडे इन दिस स्पेसिफिक सेशन दैट इज डाइवर्सिटी इन लिविंग ऑर्गेनिज्म पार्ट सेकेंड। यू हैव ऑलरेडी टोल्ड दिस पार्ट वन एंड दिस सेशन इज फॉर साइंस स्टूडेंट 9th स्टैंडर्ड क्लास। और इस टॉपिक पर आपको जानकारी देने के लिए हमारे साथ जुड़ चुकी है हमारी एक्सपर्ट। आप हैं डॉक्टर प्रियंका वार्ष्णेय, असिस्टेंट प्रोफेसर, लेडी इरविन कॉलेज, यूनिवर्सिटी ऑफ दिल्ली। वेरी वार्म वेलकम मैम।
थैंक यू रेणु मैम। हाउ आर यू मैम?
मैम, आई एम डूइंग गुड। आई होप यू आर ऑल्सो डूइंग गुड।
यस मैम, आई एम ऑल्सो गुड।
एंड आई जस्ट विश हमारे जितने भी व्यूवर्स हैं वो सभी अच्छे हों और अच्छा कर रहे हों। और अगर आपके मन में कोई भी क्वेरी आ रही है डियर व्यूवर्स, तो आप अपनी क्वेरी अपने तक ना रखें, डू शेयर इट विद अस। फील फ्री टू कॉल अस ऑन आर टेलीफोन नंबर दैट इज 8800-440-559 और यू कैन मेल अस ऑल्सो। आर ई मेल एड्रेस इज dth.class9@cit.tech.in। Those were the ways through which you can connect us in this live phone-in session. We are waiting for your queries and your phone call. So, ma'am, without any further delay, let's move towards this particular topic, that is diversity in living organism, that is part second. And हमारे जो viewers हैं उन्होंने part first भी सुन लिया है। और dear viewers, मैं आपको यहाँ पे बता दूँ कि अगर आप जानना चाहते हैं और वो दोबारा सेशन दोबारा सुनना चाहते हैं, तो आप हमारे यूट्यूब चैनल पर जाकर वो सेशन दोबारा एक्सप्लोर कर सकते हैं, सुन सकते हैं। सो मैम, लेट्स क्विकली मूव टुवर्ड्स दिस पर्टिकुलर टॉपिक। और टॉपिक शुरू करने से पहले हम आपसे जानना चाहेंगे हमारे पार्ट वन के बारे में। प्लीज़ हमारे ब्रीफ में कुछ बताएं।
थैंक यू मैम। फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल आई वुड लाइक टू विश अ वेरी गुड आफ्टरनून टू ऑल माय व्यूअर्स। एंड एज यू सेड, आई हैव मेड वन स्लाइड मैम। आई विल बी शेयरिंग द स्लाइड विद द स्टूडेंट्स एंड थ्रू दैट आई वुड लाइक टू शेयर व्हाट वर द की इंपॉर्टेंट पॉइंट्स दैट वी हैड डन इन द प्रीवियस सेशन एंड फ्रॉम देयर ऑनवर्ड्स आई वुड लाइक टू टेक माय डिस्कशन फॉरवर्ड।
या श्योर,
थैंक यू। सो स्टूडेंट्स, एज यू सी इन दिस स्लाइड आई हैव टेकन आउट द इंपॉर्टेंट पॉइंट्स दैट वी हैव डिस्कस्ड इन द प्रीवियस सेशन। We had started this chapter of diversity in living organism in last class, in last session, and there I had discussed these aspects, broad concept of diversity. We had talked about biological diversity among living organisms. We had talked about need, importance, and significance of understanding the biological diversity. Along with that, we had also talked about the basis of classification. What is the basis on which we classify the biological world? And we had also tried to relate the concept of classification with evolution. So this was the basic foundation, ma'am, that we had done in the previous session. Now I would like to move on.
Yes, ma'am.
So students, as you can see, these are the key points of discussion today. Here, today we will be talking about the hierarchy of classification, means dividing the organisms into various groups and what is the criteria. I will also be talking about the five kingdom classification by Robert Whittaker, which was given in 1969. And I will also talk about the basis of this five kingdom classification. What is the criteria? What is the basis on which we divide organisms into five broad kingdoms? And then the further division rules. So I'll be talking about that. And very briefly, I would like to make my learners familiar with a lot of diversity which is there in our surrounding. In that, I will be talking about the brief features of all five kingdoms. So learners, these are the key points of discussion today. Let's move on. So I would like to start today's discussion, ma'am, with this slide. Here we had ended the last session, in the previous session. There I had asked students to please go through the names of all the five kingdoms. Here I would like to start. So students, as you can see, that if we start looking at the hierarchy of classification and the kingdom system, which is given by various scholars in the field of science, here we find three names, which are very, very, I would say, prominent and eminent. These were Ernst Haeckel in 1894, approximately 125, 130 years back. Mm-hmm. He was this biologist who talked about the hierarchy of classification and kingdom system. And then after that, we had Robert Whittaker, who gave this classification kingdom system, five kingdom classification in 1969. This is very famous and this is something that we majorly follow. But apart from that, in 1979, Carl Wundt also tried dividing one kingdom, that is Monera, where primarily we have bacteria and related organisms, into two groups, that is Archaebacteria and Eubacteria, which means true bacteria. So in these three classification systems, ma'am, the main importance which is given to that R.H. Whittaker kingdom classification, five kingdom classification. So I will be elaborating upon this five kingdom classification by R.H. Whittaker.
Okay.
So students, as you can see, we have five kingdoms given by R.H. Whittaker in 1969. The names of these kingdoms are Monera, Protista, Fungi, Plantae, and Animalia. These are the five kingdoms which were given by R.H. Whittaker. Means R.H. Whittaker said that whole biological world, this biological diversity can be divided into five kingdoms. Means there is a variation among the organisms, but this is possible to group them, to divide them into five kingdoms. Let's move ahead.
Yeah.
I have taken this diagram, students. As you can see, with the help of this diagram, at the base of this diagram, there is kingdom Monera. Means this is primitive. It has unicellular organisms. It has prokaryotic type of cell. It has primarily, I would say, bacteria. So bacteria is something that we have heard a lot in case when we talk about the diseases, when we talk about other related things, we say bacterial infection is there or bacteria has been heard. So they belong to the kingdom which is known as Monera. Okay. And there is one difference, in basic difference, I would say, in Monera kingdom and other kingdoms, that Monera kingdom has organisms which are prokaryotic in nature. And prokaryotic means the design of cell. The design of cell is prokaryotic, means they have certain features which are different than the other organisms, the cells of other organisms. In my coming discussion, I will be also talking about the difference between the prokaryotic types of cells and eukaryotic types of cells.
Okay.
So, yes, ma'am. So I am just going a little slowly so that students are able to make sense of it.
Exactly.
Now, after Monera, students, when you move ahead, you see there is a kingdom which is known as Protista. Protista, one similarity with Monera, again they are unicellular in nature, but they are not prokaryotic. Cell design is not prokaryotic, they are eukaryotic in nature. Protista onwards, Protista, Fungi, Animalia, Plantae, they all have eukaryotic cells. Only Monera has prokaryotic cells, and there is a clear-cut difference in between the prokaryotic nature of cell and eukaryotic nature of cell. So when cells are prokaryotic and eukaryotic in nature, their functioning, designing, every aspect is drastically different. So this is very important to understand and remember what is the difference between Monera kingdom and Protista, Fungi, Animalia, and plants. So, as I was saying, students, for the sake of clarity, I have written here, there are three major criteria or the basis of classifying biological diversity or organisms into five kingdoms. First one is cell structure. Cell structure means whether the cell is prokaryotic in nature or eukaryotic in nature. As I just said, it is a cell structure. What is the structure of cell? Is it prokaryotic in nature or is it eukaryotic in nature? If it is prokaryotic, it belongs to Monera group, Monera kingdom. If it is eukaryotic nature, it has the possibility of belonging to Protista, Plantae, Fungi, or any. Okay? Now, second, mode and source of nutrition. This is very important. Whether we are able to make food for ourselves on our own, like in case of plants and many other organisms, or we are dependent on the outer source of food. For example, human beings are heterotrophic in nature. We cannot make our own food. We get the food from outside. We grow the food. So we get the food from plants. So we are heterotrophic in nature. But there are organisms like plant and other organisms also which are able to manufacture their own food. They are known as autotrophic in nature. And there is one other group of organisms which are saprophytic in nature. They are dependent on the dead and decaying organic matter like fungi. So this is also one of the important criteria of classifying the organisms into different kingdoms. The third one is body organization. Means whether the organism is unicellular in nature, means at a certain level simplistic in nature, or it is multicellular in nature. It has multiple cells which are working in sync with each other. They are making the tissues, they are making the organs, they are making the organ system. So the level of complexity. So for example, ma'am, if I talk about human beings, we are multicellular.
Okay.
And we have organization of cells in a very, very complex and sophisticated manner. We have cells, we have tissues, we have organ systems like digestive system, respiratory system, circulatory system, excretory system,
right,
nervous system, endocrine system. So human beings have very high level of organization of body. So that is what is the criteria of division of multiple organisms into different kingdoms. So students, remember cell structure, eukaryotic or prokaryotic, their mode of nutrition and body. These are the primary criteria of divide. As I promised, very briefly, I am showing you the difference between the prokaryotic and eukaryotic cell. Prokaryotic cells are those cells primarily unicellular in nature. Nucleus is not there. When I say nucleus is not there, nuclear material is there. DNA is there, RNA is there, but well-defined nuclear membrane is not there in prokaryotic organisms. So when we talk about bacteria, bacteria does not have well-defined nucleus. It doesn't have nuclear membrane. And also there is an organelle nucleolus. This is absent in prokaryotic cells. And there are various cell organelles like blastid, mitochondria, Golgi body. They are also absent in prokaryotic organisms, means in bacteria. Bacteria is there as an example of prokaryotic cell. Blue-green algae, which we call, students never be confused with this term blue-green algae. Blue-green algae are actually, they are belonging to Monera kingdom and they are bacteria. Because they have the capacity of manufacturing the food, that's why we call them blue-green, because the photosynthesis process is there. Now, another group, ma'am, which is eukaryotic in nature, they may be unicellular and multicellular, like protista and other groups. Nucleus is well-defined. In eukaryotic, we have to remember, students, nucleus is well-defined means the nuclear membrane is there. Other organelles are also there, like nucleolus is there, plastid is there, mitochondria, Golgi body. They are also there. So you will see the functioning, the efficiency with which cell will work will also increase when the cell is eukaryotic as compared to the cell when it is prokaryotic. So this is the difference between the kingdom Monera and other kingdoms. And examples of course like fungi, plant, animal cells, they are all eukaryotic cells. So here, if we see, this is a flowchart. I have taken this flowchart from NCERT book only, ma'am, because it was a good representation. So I thought we should take the example from our own NCERT book. So students, you can see here, if we go for the classification and division of organisms, we can primarily divide them into prokaryotic or eukaryotic in nature. If they are prokaryotic, they are mostly unicellular and the kingdom is Monera. If they are eukaryotic, again, there is diversity. They may be unicellular in nature like protista group, or they may be multicellular in nature. When they are multicellular in nature, there is again one level of classification and criteria, that is whether they have cell wall or they do not have cell wall. Around the cell, there is a material which makes it hard and which gives it protection. We call it cell wall. So if cell wall is there, cell wall is there, but they are not having photosynthesis. They are not able to manufacture their food on their own. They are not autotrophic in nature. They are saprophytic in nature. Then they form the group which is known as fungi. Here I would take one moment to clarify this. Before R.H. Whittaker, when people were trying to evolve the classification system, many people thought because of similarity, they put fungi into plantae group. But later on, there were so many characteristics, including the nature of the cell wall and the mode of nutrition and other things. And on the basis of that, it was decided that fungi will form a separate kingdom. It is not a part of plant kingdom. So never be confused that fungi are the plants, because they have cell wall, that's fine, but they do not perform photosynthesis. At the same time, if cell wall is there, like plants have a cell wall which is made up of cellulose, and they are able to manufacture their food on their own, they are able to do photosynthesis, then it belongs to the kingdom which is known as plant. Okay, so this is with regard to cell wall. Cell wall is there, but they are able to do the photosynthesis or not will make the two kingdoms, fungi and plantae. But at the same time, if cell is there but cell wall is not there, it is flexible. Cell wall is not there, so of course it is going to be flexible if there is no defining boundary. This cell belongs to Animalia group. Eukaryotic in nature, maybe unicellular or multicellular without cell wall, and of course they are not able to do photosynthesis. They are not able to do photosynthesis. Okay, so this is the five kingdom classification by R.H. Hottinger, which was given in 1969. And if you study that, it very clearly tells you the criteria and the basis on which organisms have been divided. This I have already said, students. Who's in 1977 means Carl Wu introduced one more division, that was he divided bacteria into archibacteria and eubacteria, and this is also in prevalence. People accept that also, because in bacteria there is a lot of diversity. But at this moment I will not go into detail, because when you go to higher classes and you take science, it is there. And at the same time, if you are interested, I would encourage and motivate you to please go and explore more about archibacteria and eubacteria.
Okay.
Ma'am, after this five kingdom classification, I would like students to know, I would like to introduce what are the different levels of classification. Because there is a one full-fledged branch of science, this is known as taxonomy. It deals with the classification of organisms. And there are different levels. There is a difference, different levels at the hierarchy of classification. So whenever we see some, let's say, for example, there are people who are investigating, they are searching and, you know, discovering various new species every other day. In India, Western Ghat, which is in the western part of India, is a rich source of a lot of diversity. Is there. So people are searching that. But when they come across any new species, they feel that, you know, it might be the new species. It has not been documented before. We have not seen it. So they can't just name the species like that. They follow the system. First of all, they will identify which kingdom we can put this species into.
Exactly.
Whether this is protista, plant, animalia. So first they will decide the kingdom. After kingdom, they will see whether we need to create one phylum for it. We need to put that into one phylum or division. Usually the word phylum is used for animals. If it is seen and it is estimated to belonging to the animal group, then we go for phylum. If it is belonging to plants group, we go for division. And next we see the class. What is the class? Which class we can put this organism into? What will be the order? What will be the family? What will be the genus and species? So genus and species are the most specific ones at the foundation of hierarchy. So any organism, any scientific name which is given, usually there is a lot of discussion. For example, if cockroach is there, so what is the scientific name of cockroach? So cockroach, scientific name of cockroach is Periplaneta americana. So Periplaneta americana is the genus and species. But if you go on identification and putting the cockroach into the hierarchy system, we need to identify kingdom, of course, Animalia, then phylum, class, order, family, genus, species. So this is the way we classify any organism. For example, ma'am, I thought that it will be very theoretical for students, so I have taken this example for of classification. This is a mango tree. So mango tree is there. I want to classify mango tree in the classification system. So what will I do? First, I will see kingdom, of course, planty, division, angiosperms, class, dicotyledony, order, sapindales, family, Anacardiaceae, genus, Mangifera, species is indica. So binomial scientific names become Mangifera indica. So the scientific name of mango tree is Mangifera indica. Mango is Mangifera indica. And this is the whole classification. So we need to understand, we follow full system. And one important thing I would like to say, students, is that all the organisms which are belonging to, let's say, they are very close. So they may have one family, they may have one order, they may have one class, they may have one division, or they may have one kingdom. So like, for example, kingdom planting, it's so vast. We will go, it is so vast. But if some plants are very similar, they may have a same family. They may look very similar. Their flowers, their stem, their leaf, they will have very similar features as compared to very distant apart plants. So this is also plant, this is also plant, but they look so different because they are not closely related. But if you go down and down, like division, class, order, family, they come closer and closer and closer. So the basic unit of classification is species. And of course, I have said in my previous session also, species is nothing but it includes all the organisms that are similar enough to breed and perpetuate. Means they have, they can interbreed, they can reproduce with each other.
Ma'am, I need to stop you a bit. I just need to tell you that we have only 5 minutes left in our session.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. Hmm. Thank you for reminding, ma'am. I will be able to manage my time for you.
Hmm. Sure, ma'am. Please go ahead.
So, yes, thank you. So, students, as I promised, I'll be talking briefly about different kingdoms in this class so that you are at least introduced to the diversity of organisms. Monera, they are unicellular prokaryotes. Hmm. They lack a true nucleus. They may or may not contain a cell wall, and they may be heterotrophic or autotrophic in nature, like blue-green algae. They are autotrophic in nature, but other bacteria are heterotrophic. So example is bacteria and cyanobacteria. Here, I have got the visuals. You can see bacteria also has a lot of diversity. There are many forms and shapes, like coccus, you know, staphylococcus and bacillus. There are different forms of bacteria. Then protista group, they are unicellular but eukaryotic in nature, and they may be autotrophic and heterotrophic both. Autotrophic examples like diatoms, Eubulina, they are autotrophic in nature, and amoeba, which is quite very common example of protista.
Right.
This is heterotrophic in nature. And they may contain pseudopodia, cilia, flagella for the locomotion. So this is the group which is known as protista. These are different examples, students. You can see like slime mold, amoeba, Eubulina, diferentiate, paramecium, diatom. These are all examples of protista group. Now fungi, multicellular, eukaryote. And saprophytic mode of nutrition means they are dependent on the dead and decaying organic matter for their food. And the cell wall is made up of chitin, not cellulose, chitin. They live many times, they live in a symbiotic relationship, which is known as lichen. So here I would just give a small task to students. Students, if you are interested, please go and explore more about the lichens and their usability in our daily life.
Sure, ma'am.
These are different visuals, ma'am, of fungi. They are of different types. It's not just the mushroom. They are of different types. And this is the common one that we see. For example, for many science experiments, we use yeast and cooking also. For cooking, we use yeast to raise the dough. And then mold. Many times if some bread or something is left and we are not able to attend to that, then this mold grows. Because these mold particles are there in the environment. And then they develop. When they get the moisture and food, they develop. And of course, mushroom is one form of food, and other for other purpose also, mushroom is used. Lichens, these are the visuals of lichens. They grow on the tree stems and other areas also, on rocks as well. Plantae group, ma'am, as I said, multicellular, eukaryotic. Their cell wall is not chitin, the cell wall is cellulose, and they are able to make their own food. They are photosynthetic, they are autotrophic in nature. There, I'll just show the very brief classification. We can divide kingdom plantae into thallophyta, bryophyta, teratophyta, gymnosperm, angiosperm, trees, algae. These are all examples of kingdom plantae. I have just got the visuals, ma'am. I will not be elaborating much because that we will be doing specifically in next session.
Exactly, ma'am.
To show the diversity of plant group to students, like cycas, pinus, mango tree. Animalia also, there is a lot of diversity. They are multicellular, eukaryotic in nature. They are heterotroph. They are not able to make their own food. They are dependent on external source, and they are very diverse. So, I have got this diagram. This diagram is going to tell the students in one say, we can divide animal kingdom into invertebrates and vertebrates, and we start from sponges. Many times we feel sponge can be animal, but yeah, actually it belongs to the animal group. Sponges are also animals, and we go till the human beings and other higher organisms, animals. So this is animal group, student, and these are some of the visuals. You can see earthworm, ascaris, cockroach, starfish, snail. So this is the beautiful diversity which is there in our surrounding. And this is the lovely thing which is there.
Yeah.
So ma'am, this was it, and this is the end of my conversation.
Yeah. Thank you so much, ma'am, for your detailed information on diversity in living organism part 2. There is so much diversity in living organism that we can see around us. Thank you so much for your detailed information. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.
And dear learners and students, it's time for me to wrap up this session. Thank you so much for watching us, and be with us for more informative sessions. Me, Renu Bhatti, signing off. Namaskar.